Hi, in this video we are going to look at the overview of mortgage-backed securities and consumer mortgage market. So the first four topics related to mortgage-backed securities is what we are going to look here. We'll talk about the characteristic of mortgage loan, discuss the major players, address the various risks associated for the MBS, and we'll try to also understand the eight key attributes that define mortgages. We'll also look at specific knowledge of amortization types and prepayment and allocation of interest and principal amount for various mortgages type. And the whole idea here is to understand the prepayment risk. So let's jump into it. The key attributes that define mortgage. A mortgage is a loan secured by real property as collateral and may be repossessed by lender if the borrower is in default. A servicer is compensated by lending for collecting the payment from the borrower and forwarding them to the investor. Servicer will also liaise directly with borrowers in the event of payment delinquencies or loan foreclosure. Client status. When the mortgage is first line or second line or subsequent line will greatly impact the line's ability to recover the balance owing to the event of default. For example, a first line would give the lender the first right from a seniority perspective. A first line is more desirable than a second line. The next setting is original loan term. Mortgage loan terms are 10 to 30 years and 30 years is the most common. However, medium terms loan 10 to 20 years are starting to become more common given the desire that people want to pay back loan quickly. Credit classification. Classifying loan between prime and subprime is determined mainly by credit score, which is FAIR, ISAC, Corporation or FICO model. Now, a prime A grade loan constitute most of the outstanding loan. They have low rate of delinquency and default and low loan to value ratios, far less than 95%. The borrower with stable and sufficient income or front income, a ratio of no more than 28% of monthly income to serve payment relating to home and bank income ratio, and no more than 36% plus other debt, and a strong history of repayment, which is FICO score of 660 or greater. Home payments include interest, principal, property tax and homeowner insurance. The loan to value compares the loan amount on the property to its fair market or appraisal value. The lower the better for the ratio from the perspective of the lender. Income ratios evaluate the level of incomes level compared to total size of the mortgage payment. Front ratios divide total monthly payment by monthly income on a pre-tax basis. Back ratios are calculated in similar fashion but instead add other borrower loans. Now, subprime loans have higher rate of delinquency and default as compared to prime loans, and they could be associated with high loan to value, 95 or above. Borrower with lower income level and borrower with marginal or poor credit history, that is FICO score below 660, are generally these kind of loans. High loan to value suggests high risk of default. Upon issuance, subprime loans are carefully scrutinized by servicer to ensure timely payment. Alternatively, A loans are the loans in between prime and subprime. Although they are essentially prime loan, certain characteristics of alternative A loan make them riskier than prime loan. For example, loan value may be unusually high, loan to value may be higher, there may be less documentation like income verification, down payment sources. So that was about the classification. We now move to the interest rate type. Fixed rate mortgages have a set of interest for the term of the mortgages. Payment are constant for terms and consist of blend amount of interest and principal. Adjustable rate mortgages have a rate change throughout the term of the mortgages. The rate is usually based on base rate, which is prime rate or LIBOR plus a spread. Rate can usually change on month, semiannual or annual basis. The risk of default is high if the rate increases after the first year, thereby significantly increasing the total payment amount due to increase in interest. Now, there are two types of adjustable rate. फिक्स्ड पीरियड एआरएम एंड नेगेटिव एमोर्टाइजेशन एआरएम। फिक्स्ड पीरियड एआरएम इज एन इनिशियल सेट रेट दैट स्टेट कांस्टेंट फॉर रिलेटिवली लॉक टाइम लाइक 3 to 10 years एंड देन चेंज द इनिशियल इंटरेस्ट रेट कैप इज जस्ट डिस्क्राइब्ड एज वेल अ पीरियोडिक रेट कैप दैट सेट्स अ लिमिट ऑन द बेस रेट चेंज एट द एंड ऑफ इनिशियल पीरियड एंड फ्यूचर रीसेट पीरियड। There is also a life rate cap that sets a limit on the rate that can be charged for the term of mortgage. The negative amortization ARM has very low initial set rate that adjusts on monthly basis, but the minimum payment is adjusted only annually and the payment cap limits the payment increases at reset. As a result, it is possible for mortgage payment to be less than interest payable when interest rate rise significantly. The loan amount is increased by the deficient interest, thereby resulting in negative amortization. There will be a significant payment increase when it is time to start amortizing the principal balance. So the prepayment increases in the negative amortization. And as the name suggests, this is negative amortization. We now move to the amortization type. Usually all mortgages are fully amortized in that the payment are calculated as if the mortgage will be paid off at the end of the amortization period. With a fixed rate mortgages, the payment will be constant for the term of the life. With ARM, the payments are recalculated after each adjustment period based on the new interest rates. In both cases, an attempt is always made to set the payment debt level so that the principal balance will theoretically be zero at the end of amortization period. However, there are interest-only payment scheme now being used in the marketplace for fixed rate mortgages. Interest-only payment scheme are required to pay set period and after that the mortgage is reset to amortize the outstanding principal balance over the life of the loan. The combination of adding a principal component to the payment and amortization over short period and results in dramatically higher payment amount. A sample IO scheme is also used for hybrid ARM. The term IO and fixed rate period are the same. The terms of IO and the fixed rate period are same. Similar to the fixed rate mortgages, IO aspect could result in significantly changes to the payment amount due to increase in interest rate and principal amortization. There is also non-contiguous interest-only hybrid ARM. The IO period is not the same as the fixed rate period. Assume 10 years IO period and 5 years fixed rate period. After 5 years fixed rate period is over, the interest rate is reset. And for the next 5 years, higher amount of interest is spent corresponding with the new rate to avoid negative amortization. When 10-year interest-only period is over, the mortgage payment will further increase to amount the principal amortization. The idea is to avoid sudden increase in payment usually associated with the simultaneously resetting and recasting of ARM. Then we have credit guarantees. The ability to create mortgage-backed security requires loans that have credit guarantees. Government loans are those that are backed by federal agency like Guinea Mac. Conventional loans could be securities by either government-sponsored enterprises. So they are GSE, which is Freddie Mac or Fannie Mac. For a guarantee fees, the GSE will guarantee payment of principal and interest to the investor. Recently, cost reasons have resulted in conventional loan being securitized as private level transaction, usually to subordination. Private level transaction also arise because some loans do not meet credit requirement stipulated by the GSE. Now we move to the loan balances. The GSE limits the loan period that qualifies for guarantee. Any loss larger than the limit, jumbo loan cannot be included into GSE pool and must be securitized in private label transaction. In general, GSE loan as limits has increased over the time due to real estate appreciation. So there are many more transactions being done through GSE various private label. Next heading is prepayment and prepayment penalties. Prepayment reduce the mortgage balance and amortization period. They can occur because of the following reasons. Home is old. refinancing due to lower rate and partial repayment by borrowing the term. To counteract the negative effect of prepayment, many loans contain prepayment penalties. Their amount to payable to servicer for prepayment with certain time and or certain amount. Soft penalties are those that may be waived off on the sale of the home. On hard penalties cannot be waived. Mortgage loan mechanics and calculate the mortgage payment factor. Mortgage payment factor applies to fixed rate mortgages because the principal balance is paid off over the term. Payment amount is constant even though the breakdown between principal and interest always change. And payment monthly is equal to original loan value. And on the numerator and denominator, we have in the numerator we have r into 1 plus r to the power t. In the denominator we have 1 plus r to the power t minus 1, where r is monthly interest rate, t is term of the loan. Let's look at a question here. So suppose the mortgage balance is 2 million. Interest rate is 4.8%. Monthly interest rate is 0.4%. Loan term is 25 years, 300 month. Calculate the monthly payment factor. So monthly payment factor is 0.004, that's monthly interest rate, into 1.004 to the power 300, and payment is divided by 1.004 to the power 300 minus 1. So monthly payment factor is 0.0572997, and the resulting monthly mortgage payment will be 1146. So this is very same formula. So original loan balance into r into 1 plus r to the power t divided by 1 plus r to the power t minus 1, and that would give us the payment monthly. Now allocation of loan principal and interest over time for various type of loan is interesting. And fully amortization fixed rate mortgages, the mortgages payment consists primarily of interest in earlier. The interest is calculated on declining principal balance. More of the fixed mortgages payment will be applied toward reducing the principal amount. The crossover point is the point in the mortgage where principal interest allocation are the same. After that point, relatively more amounts will be allocated to principal. Mortgages with shorter amortization result in less principal paid and more payment applied toward reducing the principal balance sooner. Equity buildup occurs at a quicker rate, the amortizing period is shorter. Now if you look at the payment interest principal, the payment of interest decreases and the payment of principal increases as the time passes. And the loan balance for 15 and 30 months will decrease. So fixed IO mortgage in comparison to a 5 IO mortgage to a fully amortized principal, both 25 years term, the principal and outstanding after 5 years will be higher for IO because none of the principal would have been repaid. Naturally, the prepayment made during first year would be lower for IO versus fully amortizing mortgage. For the mortgage revert to fully amortizing for the remaining period, the payment will be higher for IO because same principal loan need to be amortized over shorter period. Amortizing ARM, the initial mortgage payment is calculated on initial interest rate for the entire terms. For every subsequent rate adjustment, a new monthly payment is calculated using the rate and the remaining term. Assuming the rate increases, mortgage payment should increase primarily for account the increase in interest payable. In theory, the amount allocated to the principal repayment should not really change from the amount initially calculated. Then we have IO hybrid ARM. Payment are similar to fixed rate IO. Now to illustrate, assume a 100,000 mortgage with 5-year payment, 5-year fixed rate period, 10-year interest only period and 30-year term. The initial rate is fixed to be 5%, which results in a monthly payment of 417. When loan is reset after 5 years, the new rate is 6%, the monthly payment increase to 500, which is interest only. So first it was fixed rate, then it became interest only. And after IO period 10 years, the mortgage is reset to amortizing for the remaining 20 years. So you can see that the increase of the payments. Then we have negative amortization ARM. Payment option mortgage have a low initial rate for a very short period. After period, the rate monthly changes and it assumably increases. However, minimum payments is based on lower initial rate and 30-year amortization period, resulting in very low payment amount. That amount does not change until after 1 year. When mortgage is recast in 1 year, the minimum payment is increased, but the increase may not exceed 7.5%. As a result of interest rate increase, 7.5% increase ceiling, it is quite possible that minimum payment will be insufficient to cover full monthly interest payment. The result is negative amortization, where deficient interest increases the principal balance. When the outstanding principal balance reaches 115%, the original mortgage amount, the mortgage recast to amortize outstanding balance in the remaining term. No matter what, the loan will be required to be recast after the initial 5 to 10 years period. And the payment will increase, will no longer limit to 7.5% ceiling. Now, risk associated with mortgage product. So we have prepayment risk that is associated with the mortgage payment. When interest rate are falling, mortgage security holder face the risk that a relatively high rate investment will be cashed in. Reinvestment of those funds would generally only be possible at lower prevailing rate, thereby lowering overall investment performance. Managing with a high rate of interest have higher prepayment risk because they are more likely to be refinanced when interest rate falls. Of course, mortgage with low interest rate will have lower prepayment risk because probability of refinancing is still low. Additionally, the rate of prepayment risk will change as interest rate changes and the result in the cash flow fluctuation in mortgage and mortgage securities. Hedging such instrument then become very complex and costly. Reasons for prepayment. Borrowers may repay their mortgage due to sale or destruction of property or desire to refinance. Prepayment may occur because of borrower have defaulted mortgage and lender is forced to sell the property to cover the mortgage. Finally, many mortgages prepayment prevailing curtailment that may be used, especially when borrower exceeded cash available to do so. The level of refinancing is a function of three major factors. This is the thing that could be asked as question. So, level of interest rate, yield curve shape and alternative financing. Negative convexity. Regular fixed income securities appreciation in value as interest rate decreases with mortgage security. However, prepayment rate increases as decrease interest rate, thereby reducing the price appreciation of mortgage security. When interest rate increases, prepayment rate decreases, thereby increasing the relative price of mortgage securities, the amount greater than regular fixed income securities. Now, credit and default risk. Credit analysis pertaining to mortgage security. Key difference here is that quantifying the characteristic of worst number of underlying loan in a mortgage security, determining how these characteristics will be reported from a performance evaluation also needs to be considered, like best, worst, likely case scenario. Similar to mortgage credit scores, LTV are used to predict, and delinquencies, and they have got three classification. Payment due in 29 days is current, 30 to 59 is 30 day delinquent, 60 to 89 is 60, 90 days or more is 90 plus. Some delinquency may result to default. Default is most common for loans that are more than 90 days. Loss severity refers to that amount of loss on loan after proceeds have been recovered. In general, a default loan with higher LTV will result in higher loss severity. However, default loan with LTV may have losses because the market value of property is far less than the appraised value. Let's look at some questions. Which of the following among generally represent maximum number of days loan can be past due for a considered current? So for current is 29 days. Which of the following would least likely affect the amount of refinancing activity? So the level of default will increase losses and reduce the return on mortgage investment. However, level of default would not have any explainable impact on the level of refinancing activity. Which of the following type mortgage characterized by low interest rate for a very short period of time, followed by recasting the mortgage on an annual basis? So that's negative amortization. So an example of negative amortization would be payment option mortgage, which has low interest rate for a period of time, 1 or 3 months. After that, the rate changes monthly. And there is a numerical which says that the fully rate amortized mortgage was established exactly 1 year ago with an opening balance of 150,000, interest rate of 4.2%, 30-year terms. Current interest rate is 4.8%. What is the amount that represent the monthly payment for the next year? So this is fixed rate fully amortization. So when there is fixed rate, we are going to use the old rate. And so old rate was 4.2. We'll use that to calculate monthly term. Loan term is 360 months. So that is 0.0035 into 1.00 to the power 360. And in denominator, we have 1.0 to the power 360 minus 1. So that becomes 0.004890 and you multiply that with 150,000. And if the figure, next question, if alternative A loans are between prime and subprime, although they are essentially prime loans and they have FICO score greater than 660, certain characteristics of prime is no verification or low income, making them riskier than prime loans. So that was the difference. So that was my session on the overview of mortgage and consumer market. I hope this was helpful and added something to your current knowledge base. Thank you. Hi, we are now going to look at basics of residential mortgage-backed securities. So let's look at securitization. Summarize the securitization process of resident mortgage-backed security. To reduce the risk from holding a potentially undiversified portfolio of mortgage loans, a number of financial institutions like originators will work together to pool residential mortgage loans with similar characteristics into a more diversified portfolio. They'll sell the loan to separate entity called special purpose vehicle in exchange for cash. An issuer will purchase these mortgage assets in the SPV and then use the SPV to issue mortgage-backed security to investor. The securities are backed by mortgage loans as collateral. As of now, securitization process has become a crucial part of US credit system. Financial institutions expect to originate mortgage loans and sell them to securitization. The lack of securitization market for mortgage would lead to downfall of mortgage lending because financial institution will not be able to retain the risk. Agency-backed and non-agency-backed MBS. Now there are agency and non-agency MBS, and the major participants in residential MBS market. So agency MBS. Agency MBS are those that are guaranteed by three government-sponsored entities: GSE, Ginnie Mae, Freddie Mac. Most of the MBS issued by GSE. GSE is government-sponsored entities. Ginnie Mae's primary role is to guarantee timely payment of MBS by loan made through Federal Housing Administration Program, the Office of Public Indian Housing Program, and Department of Veteran Affairs Loan Program. The guarantor makes MBS absolutely default free. Fannie Mae is a large issuer of MBS. It has large portfolio of mortgage loan and issues debt to financial portfolio. One of the benefits of issuing debt is to add liquidity to the mortgage market and therefore of financial to institutions to lend at lower rate. Fannie Mae also provide credit guarantee on mortgage that securitized. MBS issued or guaranteed by Fannie Mae are reasonably default free. Freddie Mac is similar to Fannie Mae from an operational perspective. Its objective is to stabilize US residential market and expand opportunity for home ownership and affordable rental housing. As with Fannie Mae, MBS issued or governed by Fannie Mae are reasonably default free. Non-agency MBS. They are known as private label. The non-agency MBS segment grew along the US home crisis over 2007 credit crisis. The GSEs have restrictions on the mortgages they can guarantee or securitize, that is dollar value limit, loan to value ratio, etc., which open up the private label market for those who are willing to take on the risk inherent in non-conventional loans like jumbo loans, mortgage principal balance over the limit, and or loans with high LTV. The rising prices of the underlying home held as collateral provides some risk mitigation. Unfortunately, the falling price and credit crisis began in 2007. Caused a significant drop in MBS issued on the non-agency segment because they do not have government guarantees. Then we have the default risk. With agency MBS, the investor bears no credit risk because the GSEs have paid off a fee to guarantee the underlying mortgages. If there is a default with mortgage, the GSE will pay the outstanding balance to the investor. With a non-agency MBS, there is some credit risk, but that is mitigated through the process of subordination in a greater detail, which is discussed in the next topic. Then we have prepayment. Describe the mortgage prepayment option and factor the influence parameters. Mortgage-backed prepayment option. Mortgage prepayment come in two forms: increasing the frequency or amount of payment, and refinancing the entire outstanding balance. Prepayments are more likely to occur when market interest rates fall and borrower wish to refinance their existing mortgage at a new lower rate. For the lender, prepayments represent a loss for two reasons. They stop receiving interest income at high rate and they have to reinvest the proceeds at a lower rate. Therefore, pricing of the initial mortgage rate should be somewhat higher to take into account the possibility of prepayment. With agency MBS, prepayment and default have the same impact on the investor. Prepayment result in investor actually receiving cash from the borrower, whereas defaults, the borrower not pay the outstanding balance, but the GST does, thereby causing a prepayment. Now, some other factors influencing prepayment is that seasonality, age of mortgage pool, personal housing prices, refinancing burnout. The summer time is popular time for investors to move, and mortgages must be paid out prior to the sale of house. So it is the period time where greatest prepayment risk. Given time lag, the prepayment often start to appear in late summer and early fall. Age of mortgage pool. Refinancing offers involve penalties, administrative charges, so borrowers tend not to do until several years into the mortgage. Also, it takes some time borrower to build up equity and saving to make repayment and attempt to refinance. As a result, lower the age of the mortgage, less is the chances of repayment. Personal, marital breakdown, loss of employment, family emergencies, and destruction of rights are commonly cited reasons for prepayment based on personal reasons. It is difficult to assess this type of a prepayment risk. Property value increases may spur an increase in prepayment caused by borrower wanting to recover some of the increased equity for personal use. Property value decreases, reduce the value of collateral, reduce the ability to refinance, and therefore decrease the risk of prepayment. The increase in the popularity of home equity lines of credit where mortgage balance is revolving, that is mortgage balance can be drawn up to certain limit and paid down at time, reduces refinance prepayment risk due to the nature of the loan. Then we have refinancing burnout. To the extent that there remains significant amount of prepayment or refinancing in mortgage pool, the risk of prepayment in the future decreases. That is because presumably the only borrower remaining in the pool are those who are unable to refinance earlier due to poor credit history or insufficient property value, and those who did refinance had removed the pool already. So also those who made large prepayment instead of fully refinancing in the past fall would have exhausted their saving to make prepayment and would require quite time to do so. So refinancing burnout is a favorite question. I'll just try to go back into it one more time. So let's understand what is refinancing burnout. So to the extent that there has been significant amount of prepayment or refinancing activity in the mortgage in the past, the risk of the prepayment in the future increases. This is because presumably the only borrowers remaining in the pool are those who were unable to refinancing earlier, and those who did refinance have been removed from the pool already. So they have made large prepayment in the past and would be aggressive to make prepayment and would require some time to do so. So when there is a lot of refinancing, then after that refinancing would tend to decrease, and this is what is known as the burnout. Now describe the impact of on the MBS of the weighted average maturity, weighted average coupon, and speed of prepayment of the mortgage under like PBNs. Identify and describe contrast different standard prepayment measures. Mortgage pass-through securities. Mortgage pass-through security represent a claim against pool of mortgages. Any number of mortgages may be used to form a pool, and any mortgages included in a pool is reversed to a securitized mortgage. The mortgage in the pool have different maturities and different mortgage rates. The weighted average maturity of the pool is equal to the weighted average of all maturities in the pool, each weighted by relative outstanding mortgage balance to value the entire pool. The weighted average coupon of the pool is the weighted average of the mortgage rate in the pool. The investment characteristic of the mortgage pass-through are function of its cash flow feature and the strength of the government guarantee. Now if we look at how to visualize this, then pass-through securities receive a monthly cash flow generated by underlying pool of mortgages less servicing and guaranteeing insurance fees. The fee amount account for the fact that pass-through rates, coupon rates are less than the average coupon rate of the underlying pool. Since pass-through securities may be traded in the secondary market, they effectively convert illiquid into liquid securities. Illiquid are the mortgage and liquid securities are the bonds. And more than one pass-through may be issued against a single mortgage pool. The timing of the cash flow to pass-through does not exactly coincide with the cash flow. This is due to the delay in the time of the mortgage servicing recipient and the time the cash flows are passed to security holders. Most important characteristic of pass-through security is the prepayment risk, because the mortgage is collected for the pass-through and be repaid. Pass-through themselves have a significant prepayment risk. Now let's understand prepayment speed. This is another topic of questions, and this is also seen in CFA level 2 exam. Prepayment causes the timing and amount of cash flow for mortgage loans and MBS to be uncertain. They speed up principal repayment, reduce the amount of interest paid over the life of the mortgage. This is necessary to make specific assumptions. Two industry conventions are used, conditional prepayment rate and the Public Security Association, PSA and CPR. The CPR is an annual rate at which mortgage pool is assumed to be prepaid. The mortgage pool here is a function of past prepayment and expense feature economic condition. we convert CPR into monthly prepayment rate or known as single monthly mortality rate. And single monthly mortality is 1 minus, and in the bracket 1 minus CPR to the power 1 by 2. So an SMM of 10% implies 10% of pool beginning of the month balance less scheduled payment will be prepaid during the month. PSA benchmark assumes constant monthly payment and increases as to age has become seasonal. The PSA benchmark is expressed as a series of CPR. The PSA standard benchmark is referred to 100% PSA and assumes the gradual the following for the 30-year mortgages. So 0.2 for the first month after origination and increases 0.2 up to 30 months, which reaches CPR to 6% for 30 to 60. So we make it like this. We'll start with 0, we'll go to 30 months, and then from 30 to 60 months we are going to use 6%. So initially we are going to increase 0.2 after each month, and this is the convention. A particular pool of mortgage may exit prepayment rate faster than 100%. So a 50% refers to HAS and 200 refers to 2 times. So if the CPR for 5th and 20 months of 100 PSA. For 100 PSA, it's 5 into 0.2. If it's 150 PSA, then it's 5 into 0.2 into 150, and so on. So that's how the calculation would move. It's important to recognize that non-linear relation between CPR and SM implies that SM 150 does not equal 1.9 SM for 100% PSA. So keep in mind, PSS is not nothing more than market convention. It is more of a preventive. In fact, empirical studies on the CPR certainly differ from those number of SM. Let's look at duration and convexity. And there are questions in the exam which would use the convexity ab initio formula. The calculation of effective duration for standard pass-through MBS is different than the regular function due to increase in refinancing with decrease in interest rate. In such cases, sensitivity of the price to change interest will be lower than regular fixed income security. It is important from the duration weight hedging percentage duration estimate calculate properly or hedge will not work effectively. So we need to understand the hedge here, and that's why duration. So as we remember, we'll use the effective duration, and we'll say that P plus delta Y minus P minus delta Y upon 2 into delta Y and 1 upon P, which is the current price. And this formula comes from the same idea that we used into McClory duration, modified duration, and things like that, effective duration. So those are the three durations. Here we are using the effective duration, and we are dividing it by 1 by P. Note that the prices of MBS must consider change in prepayment speed that would occur. Now the effective convexity, and this is something interesting that you should remember for the exam, because there are high chances you are going to see this. So since the decrease in interest rate will increase the rate of prepayment, the price of MBS will not increase at a much corresponding speed. The price compression result in negative convexity, similar to callable bond, where the risk of investor forms a higher than average capital gains. Partly as a result of increasing risk, MBS provides higher yield compared to treasury securities. In other words, think of additional yield on a coupon received by investor for a call option compensation for negative capital gain. The convexity approximation formula is P delta Y plus P minus delta Y minus 2P upon delta Y square into 1 by P. So here we add everything, then we subtract minus 2P, and then we divide by delta Y square and also P, and everything we assume here as the parallel shift. So then we have the collateral mortgage obligation. So collateral mortgage obligation are structured in a way so that offer varying different level of premium risk depending on investor risk and return preferences. As a result, it may increase liquidity of securities compared to MBS. The CM are more complex than the standard MBS pass-through. In contrast to pass-through structure, CM allows for investor to alter the exposure to prepayment risk. In addition, CMO pay quarterly cash flow compared to MBS, which generally pay monthly cash flow. Agency CMOs are guaranteed, but not agency CMO are not. And they required over collateralization. The amount of assets should exceed the security pool to be marketable. Now let's look at MBS cash flow example. Now We have to understand password securities, CMO, both sequential and planned amortization classes, and interest only on prepayment strips. So let's take an example. So if you take an example, a numerical example to illustrate the first 2 months of cash flow, then we have MBS balance 600 million, mortgage pool 360 million, original mortgage WAC, WAC, that is 6.5%, and then annualized pass-through coupon 6%, and prepayment assumption 200% SPA. So month 1 and month 2, CPR, SSM, coupon, and mortgage interest, scheduled prepayment, principal repaid, pass-through interest, total cash flow, ending principal. And this is how things would work. So the CPR is 0.2, and let's try to understand all of them. So standard prepayment is 100% PSA is 0.2, and increased by 0.2 in the second month. So a 200% CPA implies that the CPR 1 is 0.4 and 0.8 for the next year, and therefore we have different SMM. Now the first one, present value, when we take the original coupon as 6.5% and we solve for payment, taking interest as 3.79. So another interesting thing here is that the mortgage interest is 3.79, and the mortgage interest rate is 6.5 divided by 2, which we will use in the interest rate, taking into account the updated coupon for first month, and we'll for second month it would be the removing the prepayment. So that's how we'll look at the outstanding principal. It's tough to explain here, but the whole idea is to understand the ending principal, the pass-through interest, total cash flow, prepaid principal, scheduled payment, mortgage interest, and coupon. So that's how things would come. So the coupon that you are going to get will be used in different ways. Now let's look at sequential CMO. In a sequential pay CMO, principal payments are divided into numerous tranches. Each tranche receives interest cash flow and possibly principal cash flow. Receipt of principal cash flow from both scheduled prepayment and unscheduled prepayment of the underlying mortgage depends on stage of principal repayment within the tranches. The first tranche principal has to be fully repaid before the next tranche receives any principal, and so on, and that's why we have this sequential name. Occasionally, a tranche Z is in a place referred to as equity tranche receives no cash flow, but interest it would have otherwise received periodically is added to the principal to be paid later. When all other tranches have been repaid, the tranche Z will become receive principal. The following continues the numerical example. So if we have four tranches, and if we have got a total principal of 600 million, which is again divided into 250, 150, 125, 75. So if in the month 1, tranche receives 250 into 6%, and they also received a scheduled payment and prepayment of 0.54 and 0.2. So total cash flow of 1.99. Tranche B and C received interest only and no principal until tranche A's principal has been paid out. The tranche B investor will receive interest, the tranche C will receive interest, tranche C will receive interest. So that's how we will look at it. To illustrate sequential nature, assume tranche A principal is fully paid out in a month and tranche B principal start to be repaid after in the month 60. Assuming tranche B is fully paid out in month 1 in later month, and then tranche C starts to be repaid. So based on the information, I'll summarize quickly. The allocation of principal repayment have a significant impact on the effective duration. The duration of tranche A is significantly lower than tranche D because of principal is being repaid in tranche A. During the entire pass-through, it is simply the weighted average of the individual tranche duration. Changes in prepayment speed will impact the timing of the retirement and effective duration. For example, if the prepayment speed assumption is decreased, then individual tranches will retire later. Now let's look at
the CMO plant amortization class, or known as PSE. In this type of CMO structure, there is at least one PSE tranche and one support tranche. The payments to the PSE tranche are held constant so that the support tranche exists to absorb actual prepayments at a higher or lower than plan. There is generally no prepayment risk for PSE tranche and significant amount of prepayment risk for the support tranche. Now the following, if you look at what we were doing in the last time, then the total cash flow divided into two tranches, tranche A, which is the PSE, and the support tranche. PSE tranche is assumed to be between 80% to 300%. Without getting into calculation, the principal amount will be 356 and 243 in PSE tranche and support tranche. The scheduled cash flow for the PSE tranche will be set a minimum cash flow of under 80% PSA and 300% PSA assumption. This will assure that the changes in prepayments fit with the original port generate cash flow that's always supported by support tranche. So if actual PSA is 100%, then actual cash flow from pass-through less the amount of scheduled to PSE tranche are absorbed. If actual percentage is 200, cash flow from the pass-through are much larger than in scenario 1, where we assume PSA 100%. The amount scheduled to PSE tranche holder will stay the same in scenario 1. This is to protect that is affordable result of having a support tranche. The excess amount received will be absorbed by the support tranche. And if the PSA is even higher and there is a limit to how much it could be absorbed by support tranche, and if the support tranche is retired, PSE's cash flow will no longer be protected. PSE tranche cash flow will now be same as regular pass-through security and subject to prepayment risk. So if it keeps on increasing PSA, then only the PSE tranche gets it. So from a valuation perspective, as long as PSA remains 80 to 300%, the support tranche still exists and there will be no change in PSA due to PSA change cash flows. But if the significant changes in price of support tranche due to significant cash flow, then the price will exhibit negative convexity due to higher negative correlation between change in interest and the PSA increases. We now move to the two strips, that is interest only strip and principal only strip. With interest only strip, investor receives only the interest cash flow from the underlying pool of the mortgages and none of the principal. Consequently, failing interest rate will increase the rate of prepayment, therefore the amount of future interest cash flow fall due to reduced amount of principal on the interest calculated. In fact, the value of IO falls dramatically when interest rate fall and PSA rises. The effective duration of PSA strip is significant and negative. This also implies strong positive correlation between interest rate and value of IO strip. Principal only strip. Principal only strip are exactly opposite to IO strip, whereby investor only receives principal cash flow and none of the interest. Again, falling interest rate will increase the rate of prepayment and the short term cash flow. Therefore, the effect of PO strip is significant and positive. And that also implies that strong negative interest rate correlation between interest rate and PO strip. So if we look at here in the principal only strip, and if the interest is falling, this will increase the rate of prepayment and also the short term cash flow. So in principal only strip, the investor only receives principal cash flows and none of the interest. So that implies a strong negative correlation between interest rate and PO strip. This is just opposite of the interest only strip, because when the interest rate increases, the rate of prepayment and the future interest cash flow will fall due to reduced amount of principal. So that if the interest rate increases, there is no prepayment and they get a higher interest. Whereas if the interest rate increases in principal only strip, the prices fall. So there is a negative correlation between interest rate and the value of PO strip. So the price yield relationship of IO and PO securities have four points that we should consider. The underlying pass-through security exhibits significant negative convexity. The PO exhibits some negative convexity at lower interest rate. The interest only is positively related to mortgage rate at low current rate. The PO and IO are more volatile than underlying pass-through. So the price and the mortgage rates, if the interest rate increases, interest only increases for some time, then it decreases, and principal only decreases when the interest rate increases. So when the interest rate increases, the people are going to pay back, so the price of the principal only strip will decrease. So this was a tricky chapter. They had some numericals, but I'll quickly talk about the important points here. So Ginnie Mae does not issue MBS, it only guarantees them. MBS are guaranteed, MBS issued or guaranteed by Freddie Mac are only relatively default free, unlike those by Ginnie Mae, which are technically absolutely default free. With non-agency MBS, the credit risk is usually mitigated through process of subordination. So Ginnie Mae does not issue CBS, remember this. MBS issued or guaranteed by Freddie Mac are relatively default free. Now seasonality does impact level of prepayment. They are noticeably higher in summertime. Increasing house prices may spur increase in prepayment caused by refinancing and mortgages. Then we have the formula SSM is equal to 1 minus in the bracket 1 minus CPR to the power 1 by 2, where we can calculate CPR. Because CMO are structured in a way as to offer various level of prepayment risk to investors, the liquidity of CMO may be higher than the standard MBS pass-through. So we can give the prepayment risk to the investor by using CMO. Agency MBS are guaranteed. There is no need to over-collateralize them. Over-collateralization will be done by non-agency MBS. Agency and non-agency MBS do not allow investor to alter their prepayment risk exposure. It's only available in CMO. CMO quarterly cash flow compared to MBS, which generally pays cash flow. And then we have some of the properties. So because the decrease in interest rate increases the rate of prepayment, the price of MBS will not increase much correspondingly. The price compression results in negative convexity, similar to callable bond, which is the risk for investor in form of higher than average negative capital gain. So that was all about the topic here. The topic we just looked at was basics of residential mortgage backed securities. We'll continue from here and we'll look at the overview of mortgage backed securities market. And then we have the valuation of MBS. I hope this was helpful. Thank you for listening. Okay, we now move to the overview of mortgage backed securities market. We look at terminologies and that will help us to get solid understanding of some of the topics. We'll be looking at agency and private label, MBS pool, pass-through, CMOs and mortgage strip. Let's understand the evolution of MBS market first to start with. Strong growth in the real estate market has led to corresponding growth in the mortgage-backed security market. As shown by wide range of diversified and MBS products that are currently in existence. The MBS market has now exceeded the size of treasury market. Investment managers are carefully studying MBS market and realizing the importance and analysis of factors that impact MBS return. This is quite interesting when you look at the MBS market, the US treasury market and the US corporate debt market, and all of them are equally important. Mortgage loans are increasingly being securitized to access capital market for funding and liquidity. The general process work is as follows. Mortgage lenders approve loan applications, issue a loan to borrow and then sell in capital market in form of MBS. Proceeds from the sales of MBS are used for new mortgage lending. Many mortgage loans and similar characteristics like interest rate term, credit quality balance are pulled together to create MBS that can be traded. The process essentially transformed was one small and relatively illiquid asset into a liquid one. Prior to existence, financial institutions accepted deposits and then loaned them. These loans remained investment assets on their books. Unfortunately, profitability was highly dependent on local economic condition and shortage of deposit fund could effectively eliminate the opportunity to issue mortgage loan. However, since 1980, mortgage lending has grown significantly into national industry and active market for mortgage securities. So let's understand agency and private label securities. MBS can be created in two ways. First, loan that meet the government agency requirement are charged an insurance premium guarantor fees by the agency and then securitized as pool. Alternatively, the loans that do not meet the requirement or where it is costly to go through the agency are securitized in a non-agency or private label. Although there is no agency guarantee security on those per se,
there is insurance in form of private guarantor or the creation of subordinate classes. The senior class is given the highest protection. After pool of mortgage is securitized, it is sold to investor as a pass-through investment. A basic example would have a principal and interest paid on proportional ownership of the pool. A common but complex example would be creation of structured security, where a pool cash flow divided into tranches to create many different types of securities to meet various needs of the investor. Those securities could have different durations, prepayment risk and credit risk. Agency fixed rate pool and pass-throughs. The lenders will go through the large portfolio of funded mortgage and group the ones with same coupons to form a pool. The lender transforms a certain amount of loan with certain coupon to the agency and in return will receive the same amount back in MBS. The MBS received could either consist solely on the pool of lender's own loan or consist of portion of pool loan from other lenders as well. Agency fixed rate MBS are traded based on the coupon rate, normally 50 BPS increment. Some of the interest cash flows are required for servicing and credit support payment. Guarantee fees are paid to government agencies to insure the loan. They will vary based on the risk assessment of the loan. High volume transaction tends to produce lower fees. Required base servicing fees are paid to servicer to perform tasks. And tasks like collecting prepayment, making tax, insurance payment, forwarding money to investors, and it's approximately 25 BP. Excess servicing or remaining interest is equal to loan minus servicing fee minus guaranteeing fee minus pass-through coupon rate. So that is remaining interest. In general, loan note must be higher than the pass-through coupon rate. The excess normally is 25 to 75 BP in range. And I think higher would be suboptimal. In that excess, servicing would be retained. Simply possible to pay the GST, the guarantor fees as capitalized upfront, so that on the ongoing basis, the pass-through coupon rate could be made higher to attract more investors. Agency adjustable rate pools and pass-throughs. The lender's loan in the pools may have range of rates, so pool's coupon will be weighted average of the loan rates and the loan balances, which is weighted average coupons. We see this term a lot, weighted average coupon, which is the loan balance set. As a result, guarantor fees are usually not paid upfront but are simply paid over time. Pools may contain loans or notes lower than the pool coupon rate, in which case there is no need for excess servicing. Base servicing fees may range from 12.5 to 37.5 BP. Adjustable rate pools are traded in old coupon up to 3 decimal places. Additionally, the coupon will change over time in the pool and they are paid off. Then we have private label pools and pass-through. In a private label pool and pass-through, no guarantee fee is involved, so there needs to be some method of credit enhancement. The most common is the use of subordination, where a portion of transaction is subordinated in terms of receiving cash flow. The process that will be first to absorb the losses, and it would protect the senior portion, whether a subordinate may be divided into separate tranches with each separate rating and exposure to credit loss. Compared to senior tranches, subordinated tranches carry more risk and likelihood of credit losses. So subordinated tranches require higher rate of return. Given the protection provided to them, the senior tranche may have very predictable cash flow just like pass-throughs. The rating agency determines the level of subordination and the relative size of the subordinated tranches required for the deal. They are decided based on determination, probability and severity of losses. Shifting interest rate structure are common with subordinated deals. General features are prepayment are initially given to senior tranches, subordinate do not initially receive prepayment but do receive scheduled principal payments. Over time, subordinate tranches increases in size, providing further protection for senior tranches. Eventually, subordinate receive pro rata shares of prepayment. Over collateralization is used when default risk is higher for subprime loans. It is the structure so that the amount of loan collateral exceeds the investment amount. Again, this provides the protection to senior tranches. So, shifting interest rate, I am repeating this again. Shifting interest rate are common with subordinated deals, and the features are like payments are initially given to prepayments. Subordinates do not initially receive prepayment but do receive the scheduled principal payments. Over the time, subordination tranches increase further putting the senior tranches. Now, agency mortgage strips. Principal only and interest rate securities are created by placing agency pool into a trust and breaking them into two components. PO strips receive principal prepayment in addition to regular principal payment. IO strip receives interest earned from them. The PO as well as the interest rate fall. PO performs well when interest rate fall because there will be more cash flows as a result of mortgage prepayment.
perform well when interest rate rises, because prepayment, there will be continued generation of interest due to lack of prepayment. A private label mortgage steps, WAC IOs and WAC POs exist only in private label market. The actual coupon rate for these securities depend on market condition. Once the deal coupon rate is set, the underlying loans are classified into discount and premium loan group. The base servicing and the trust fee are deduced from each note to arrive at the net note rate. Loans with net note rate less than the set coupon rate are discount notes, whereas those with note rate greater than the coupon rate are premium loans. Two loan groups that need to be altered to match the deal's coupon rate. The discount loans are grossed up to the deal's coupon rate by increasing PO as follows. So PO is equal to deal coupon minus note coupon upon deal coupon. So PO percent for each note is multiplied by its face value. The total of all PO created for all rates will become the size of weighted average PO. So this is the principal only strip. And on the other hand, the premium loans have some of their interest removed so as to reduce the net note rates to that of a deal coupon rate. Let's have an example here. If we consider a 50 million face value of loan with 5% note rate and a deal coupon rate of 4.5%, the total fee 30 BPS, so the net rate is 4.7. As a result, 20 BPS is stripped from the loan, thereby creating a strip where the notional value of 50 million and 0.2% coupon. The notional value of the WAC IO is the total notional value of the premium loans. The coupon of the WAC is weighted average of the strip coupons of the notional value. Based on this information, if the deal's coupon rate is changed, it will alter the allocation of loan classified as discount or premium. Therefore, it will change the signs of the WAC PO and WAC IO as well as the WAC IO coupon rate. The deal rate is dependent on investor demand on premium and discount rate, investor demand IO and POs. So we have a lot of terms here. You have to be careful. So I am repeating some of the points here. The actual coupon rate for these securities, private label mortgage strips, depend on market condition, and we take out the net note rate, and the two loan groups that need to be altered to match deal's coupon rate. The discount loans are grossed up to deal's coupon rate by creating a principal only, which is as follows. Principal only percent is equal to deal coupon rate minus note rate upon deal coupon rate. The principal only percent for each is then multiplied by its face value. Now we have the agency CMOs. Agency CMOs are established with the underwriter purchasing agency MBS, who essentially place them in a trust. Different tranches are created for principal and interest from the MBS pool. Then we have the private label CMOs. Private label CMOs are established by transferring many loans into securitized vehicle. The securitized transaction CMO is then created by the issuer. We now move to the next topic. That's creating an MBS. And it says, explain our loan progresses from application to agency pooling. Now there are four steps here, and it may take 30 or 60 days. The application is taken, rate is locked, loan is funded, and the loan is diversified into mortgage pool. In the application stage, loan is classified as either fixed rate or floating rate, which is committee pipeline or uncommitted pipeline. The rate could be locked as early as the application stage, but must be done at a point before funding. Once rate is locked, it is classified as a fixed rate, form part of the committed pipeline. The period between application and funding is required for the lenders to manage their pipeline. Activities here include underwriting the loan and preparing the related paperwork, that is appraisal, credit analysis, title search, certification. At this point, the lender is able to sell the loan for settlement in future. The lag also allows lenders to control and hedge their production pipeline to meet the profit objectives. Hedging requires lender to be aware of rates of new loan application as well as applications don't finalize. So step 1, step 2 completed, but not step 3. So application is taken, rate is locked, loan is funded, but the loan is not divided into, loan is funded. Now generally the fallout will increase significantly if the interest rate falls, as the potential borrowers will allow their loan application to lapse as they apply for loan at lower rates. So they will still apply, but they will not take the loan. Now we look at trading, pass through, securities. Now describe MBS market structure and the way fixed rate, pass through, securities trade. Trade settlements occur every month on predetermined basis. Delivery dates during a month are specified. In addition, prices are usually quoted for 3 settlement months. However, trades could be done for longer period in the future. A fixed rate pass through securities trade in one of the following ways: pre-identified pool trade, to be announced trade, or stipulated trade. Pre-identified pool trade identifies the number of balances of the pool prior to the trade. TPA or to be announced trade involves identifying the securities and establishing the price. However, there is a pool allocation process whereby the actual pool are not revealed to the seller until immediately before settlement. The characteristic of the pool can be used for TBA trades are regulated to ensure reasonable consistency. So this is how the trade in pass-through securities work. The stipulated trade is similar to the TBA trade, except that pool characteristics are provided in greater detail. The next thing here is dollar roll transaction. Explain the dollar roll transaction, how to value a dollar roll, and what factors can cause a roll to trade special. MBS trading requires same securities to be priced for different settlement dates. A dollar roll transaction occurs when MBS markets buy position for one settlement month, at the same time sell those for same position for another month. How to value a dollar roll? The process involves assessing the income and expenses related over holding period. Income is determined by coupon payment, reinvestment interest, and principal payment. Expenses are determined by financing cost. One could purchase the security in either front month, hold it, and dispose of in a later month. The back month price of the dollar roll should take into account both income and expense into account, so that the net cash flows are equivalent to simply purchasing the security in back month for settlement time. However, empirical evidence suggests that most likely outcome is the price drop between two settlement dates and make purchasing the security back months become more attractive. In other words, purchasing a position for back month settlement results in financing at an implied repo rate lower than that of the repurchase market. The factors that impact dollar value are, and there are 4, securities, coupon, age and WAC, holding period, assumed prepayment speed, and funding cost in the repo market. Factor causing dollar roll to trade special: when the prices difference or drop is large enough to result in financing at less than implied cost, then dollar rate is trading special. It is caused by decrease in back month prices, which is due to increased number of sale settlement transaction on the back month, increase in front month prices due to increased demand in front month for deal collateral, shortage of creating securities in the market that requires dealer to suddenly purchase the security for delivery in front month, thereby increasing the front month price. Now, pricing mortgage products. Compare the pricing of mortgage product to developments in MBS markets. There have been an increase in consistency of mortgage loan pricing to consumer as a result of growth in MBS sector. In setting the optimum coupon rate for a fixed rate MBS, the original is to maximize process. The optimum coupon depends on the pass through on different coupons, base servicing fee, excess servicing fee, guarantee fee, originator fee. Mortgage loans involve points where our upfront loans are fees paid by the borrower. Similar to setting the coupon rate, points are based on some factors. Calculating the optimum coupon for jumbo loans, private label loans, requires the valuation of cost of credit enhancement or usually subordination. Therefore, the weighted average price of subordination classes is considered. Calculating the opting coupon for jumbo securitization or private label requires prices of the senior tranches, the weighted average price of the subordinated bonds, weighted average cost of interest only for premium loans, and weighted average cost received for discount loans. With the securitization of alternative A loans, the choice is between GSE and a private label. One must consider the price of senior pass-through and GSE guarantee fees and compare it with the cost of credit enhancement to private label. MBS cash flow structure for investors. Explain the purpose of cash flow structuring of mortgage-backed securities. There are many different MBS investors, banks, life insurance, pensions, portfolio hedge funds, who invest in MBS for different reasons and may have particular cash flow need. For example, bank may require short-term securities and life insurance may require long-term securities. The flexible nature of MBS allows them to be used by portfolio manager in designing special investment structure to generate very specific cash flow. For example, it may be necessary to derive a consistent cash flow stream that could be replicated simply by using an interest-only stream. Consider a situation when mortgage bond makes only the scheduled payments to its investor. Although there may be certainty and stability in those cash flows, it will result in some uncertainty being transferred to the other investors. As a result, structuring MBS needs to carefully examine the trade-off as to meet the request of the investors. Now, there are few things that I would like to repeat here and that should be again studied carefully, and they are as follows. Now, MBS creation is in 4 steps and it takes 30 to 60 days. Application table, rate log, loan funded, loan delivered into the pool. Fixed rate pass-through securities trade in one of the following ways: pre-identified pool trade, to be announced trade, and stipulated trade. A dollar roll transaction occurs when an MBS market is buying a position for one settlement date and at the same time selling the same position for another month. So that's dollar transaction. Now there are many different MBS investors, bank, life insurance companies, portfolio manager, and they have different reasons and have particular cash flow needs. We are going to look quickly at the type of questions that we can get here. Now, which of the following factors would not cause the dollar value to trade special? Now, let's look at it again. So, when the drop is large enough to result in financing at less than the implied cost of funds, the dollar value is trading special. It may be caused by decreasing in back month prices due to increase in number of settlement transactions on the back month date by the originator, increase in front up prices due to increased demand in the front and deal for the collateral, shortage of certain securities in the market that require deliver to be suddenly purchased for the security in the front month, which would increase the front month prices. So these are the reasons of why a dollar roll is to be trade special. I am repeating it. So dollar roll is traded special when there is decrease in back market price, increase in front price, and shortage of securities in front month. So when these things are going to happen, then the dollar roll is going to trade special. Now, which of the following items is a fixed rate pass-through securities? Fixed rate pass-through securities are pre-identified pool trade, to be settlement trade, and stipulated trade. To be announced, pre-identified pool trade and stipulated trade. And there is nothing as mandate trade or any other term that you can get. Now let's look at over-collateralization. It's used when default risk is higher, so it would be more applicable for subprime loans. Given the senior trends are less risky, they'll trade at lower yield than subordinate. The rating agency determines the relative size of the subordinate required for a delinquency. Subordinate receive pro rata shares of prepayment under shifting interest rate structure. So that was about over-collateralization. Now, MBS market began trading in 1990. The MBS market has now exceeded the size of treasury. The creation of MBS may require many mortgage loans with similar characteristic to be pulled together. The proceeds from MBS are used for additional lending. Then the question could become of excess servicing is loan minus base servicing fees minus guarantee fees minus pass-through coupon rate. So I'm going to repeat: loan rate minus servicing fees minus guaranteeing fees minus pass-through coupon rate. That's the excess servicing. So that would do it for this session, which was the overview of MBS market. I hope it added something to your knowledge base. Thank you for listening.